question for today.
Thank you, Franziska. And what I would need in order to start a little bit with my introduction about the why, what, and when, and with whom introduction to the Data Space Support Center is sharing rights. So I need to share my screen, and I don't have granted the rights, right? Alessandra, if you could do that, I'm not sure. Otherwise,
I can maybe share. I also don't have the sharing.
So I think it must be Alessandra, if you could check out, let's say that we have the rights to share, then we can start. While we wait on my rights to share, let me also welcome everyone from my side. I'm Boris Otto, I work for Fraunhofer, and I'm involved in many, let's say, data space initiatives. And also I have the great honor to actually lead the Data Spaces Support Center. When saying that, it's not only an honor for me, but it's a great pleasure, because what we do here is a fundamental piece in successfully implementing the European data strategy. I'm not sure who is sharing now, but it would be great if we could go into presentation mode.
Can somebody... you see the screen, Boris?
Yes, I can see the screen, but I only see the SharePoint slide. So if you could go into presenter mode, that would be great. Otherwise, or could grant me, let's say, the chance to share the slides. Now is very good. So I will just say, please, to the next slide, which will I do now. So please, perfect, wonderful. So as I said, I mean, as an introduction to, let's say, our mission that we jointly have, let me stress once more, the Data Spaces Support Center plays a crucial role in making sure that the European data strategy comes into life. As you know, the European data strategy envisages a situation where we make better use of our data. Of course, because Europe's strength is sitting on tons of data and basically sitting on a data treasure. But on the one hand side, do that in a fair way. So making sure that data providers are not exploited when it comes to their asset, which is data. And on the other hand, the data users can always trust that the data comes from a trusted source. One slide ahead, please. So I structured this introduction session in three blocks mainly. I would like to, as I already started, elaborate a little bit when we look into, let's say, the overall objective of the European data strategy, how we are positioned in the various, let's say, instruments and activities which help us to implement the data strategy in Europe. And then I would like to share a couple of, let's say, thoughts about data spaces with you. Because of course, as we see emergence, creations, and also scale up of data spaces, there is still, let's say, a lot of, let's say, misunderstanding what a data space is, and more importantly, why we in the end need a data space. And I would like to touch upon this piece in particular a bit in more detail. And then I would introduce to you the fundamental, let's say, mandate, but also the work plan of the Data Space Support Center. And in doing so, I will also briefly touch upon the question, okay, how can you guys engage with the Data Space Support Center? Because in the end, we form one community, because as Franziska nicely said in the beginning, we are, let's say, the community of the data space enthusiasts. And let me also stress the point, if we don't do it, so if we don't make data spaces happen, there is no one else around it who will do that. So if we want to make sure that data spaces come to life, and in that sense also make sure that the data strategy in Europe becomes reality, and by the way, we as a society and citizens prosper and benefit from that idea, we have to do it. Right, next slide, please. So I think many of you might know this picture, which has been crafted by the European Commission, and this one comes from Daniele Rizzi, who was so kind to share a couple of thoughts with us when we had the kickoff event that also Franziska mentioned, like 1.5 months ago in the middle of October in Brussels, which, by the way, was a great event. It was excitement and also enthusiasm that you can actually feel in the room, and was just a really great experience, and also something that shows the power that Europe can create. However, the European data strategy basically reflects on two things, and I would like to touch upon those. On the left-hand side, you see everything that is related to, let's say, cloud infrastructures. And this is important because cloud infrastructures are, let's say, the fundament on which data spaces exist, right? And on the right-hand side, you see everything which is involved or related to actually data spaces themselves and the sharing of the data and the reuse of the data. And in the middle, we can see that there is lots of regulation being done over the last years under the, let's say, in the term of Ursula von der Leyen as president of the European Commission, and which is good, because in the end, all this regulation, I'm not a lawyer, so I cannot judge whether it's good or bad, but in the end, the idea is good to, let's say, put European values in the data economy into legal legislation. And I think that is a good idea, because it creates, a level playing field in the single European market when we are talking about sharing and using data. And what you can also see here, that, let's say, the Data Space Support Center on the upper right-hand side has a critical role in not only coordinating, but to a certain extent also governing the establishment of common European data spaces. So we are not, let's say, a hygiene factor, let's call it like that, where you may talk to or not. We want to make recommendations and come up with support in form of blueprints and building blocks that you then, to a certain extent, have to use if you, let's say, build a data space in a European program. However, the recommendations will be so powerful that they will also be taken up by data space initiatives that are not funded by the European Commission, for example, but through private or member state initiatives. Next slide, please. As you know, we have identified a number of domains in which the establishment of data spaces is of particular importance, and you can read them on the upper part of this view graph. And on the lower part, we see a number of, let's say, elements that in total form the technical infrastructure for data spaces. And these range from edge cloud services. By the way, this is an area where Europe can really win, in my point of view. Over smart middleware solutions, we are aware of the fact that Simple will come, so the procurement of the smart middleware platform by the European Commission. But also it relates to high performance computing, which has been around for years, and there's lots of experience that have been made and things that we can rely on. And the data space support center should also form, let's say, the glue or the link between the activities on the upper part of the view graphs, and let's say in an IT stack, we would rather call that software as a service. And in the middle and in the lower part, we would probably call it like infrastructure or platform as a service. And we want to make sure that these things go hand in hand and are, let's say, compatible and synergetic, of course. Right, one slide ahead, please. So if we look into data spaces, and this is a relatively new view graph, which I would like to elaborate a little bit with you, because I think it's important. Because when we had the kickoff and in the talks that I had with many of you in the community, there was always one thing: okay, these blueprints, it's a great idea, and we'll come to that later, and also Tuomo will outline that. It's important to look into, okay, what are technical capabilities that we need to have in place in order to run a data space? And which kind of data services do we need to put into place in order to make it happen? But there was a clear demand from you as a community. Okay, we also want to learn about, let's say, okay, what are the business case patterns which data spaces usually do support? Because it's clear you do not need for every data sharing case, you don't need in all cases a data space. However, there are a couple of, let's say, patterns that require a federated approach to data sharing. And I listed here a couple of ones and also picked a couple of examples. So in many cases, it's simply sharing a burden, a cost sharing case. Like in one part of Catena X looks into the automotive industry and the complex supply network and all the more than 10,000 companies in these supply networks are confronted with the same things. They need to have transparency where the stuff is, which kind of production capacity is available in 2 weeks from now and 10 weeks from now. They are confronted by legislation like, for example, the Supply Chain Act in Germany and so on and so forth. And it's totally clear, no single company can cope with this requirement on their own. And I can tell you that, for example, BMW are part of Catena-X. They simply did the math, you know, they calculated, okay, how much would it cost us if we would do it alone? And they said, no way, it's too costly. We can't do that. We need to team up. And since everything, every partner has the same calculation, it is clear that, let's say, teaming up is beneficial. The second pattern is joint innovation. So companies see that, okay, they see a demand by their customers and say, look, okay, we want to be innovative and come up with an innovative solution, for example, end-to-end mobility services that we as mobile citizens can use. But it's clear that in this mobility chain, no single player has all the data that is needed to do that, right? So, and if we want to have this innovation happening, we need to team up. Next thing is we want to combine forces in order to prevent some monopolistic structures to happen in certain domains. This is true in the cloud segment in general, but also, let's say, in manufacturing, where we are have a market or a domain, a sector which is dominated by a large number of small and medium-sized enterprises, which every single one of them cannot afford, let's say, the effort to build a platform with a, let's say, significant adoption. So they team up and so on and so forth. So I think there are a couple of patterns that we already can identify in this, let's say, in this stage of the adoption of data spaces, which we can learn from. And moreover, these patterns may also tell us next on the infrastructure level, which kind of data spaces we need to put into place in order to make it happen. And that would accelerate the establishment of every individual data space. If you ask yourself, okay, why did he just choose these examples? Well, I just looked into the list of Lighthouse projects, which were also happening in the Gaia-X Summit 2 weeks ago. And I just took them as a list, and also I forgot a couple of them, you know, but there are tons others around, but these were just examples who represent a certain pattern. All right, next slide, please. So I need to rush a little bit because otherwise I'm running out of time. So what we also need to understand that data spaces basically can be looked at in an architectural mode, I also said that, and we should differentiate the ecosystem view on the upper part, the infrastructure view on a lower part, so where running software services can be identified, and the middle layer, which basically would in the end, to a certain extent, create a digital twin of a certain domain or a subdomain. And what is important to understand is that on all levels, different business model logic applies. On the upper part, we should not interfere there, you know, because there are individual business models. There are startups, there are, let's say, incumbents that have a new idea, and they should just do that by using the data from the data space. On a lower part, we all have typical infrastructure service operations, like, okay, I have certain piece of software, could you please run it for me? Okay, I can do that, and I charge you a fee. Interesting is the middle layer. So who owns this data space? This data space for the digital twin, and what kind of business logic or profit pattern do we expect there? And I think it would, in many cases, end up like in a cooperative business model. So it will earn some money, but not so much that we all get zillionaires, because it basically is something that allows us to share a burden, to share something, you know. All right, next slide, please. And I really need to rush. Oh, it's a horror. And what we see is that we need to make sure in Europe, and we see that many data space initiatives are now in the second stage. So they opened up. By the way, this is also why we need a trust framework and a trust infrastructure, because we end up making business and interacting and data sharing with people that we did not know before. Therefore, I want to trust these guys, despite the fact that I don't know them, you know. And that is why we need to have trust, well, trust anchors and technology in place. And that is also why we need, let's say, an intermediary who basically organizes this. However, and this is the implementation of the European data strategy, if we look in the right-hand side, it is not the case if we talk about the mobility data space in Europe that this will be the one data space which is, let's say, handled by one monolithic project which has all the resources and then does it. No. It's the European way. In the mobility domain, we already see a huge number of different data space initiatives, which in the end need to be interoperable so that in the end they together can form, let's say, the overarching mobility data space in Europe. And that is why we need to make sure that interoperability between data spaces is assured. Interoperability not only in regard to the data that's going to be exchanged, but also in terms of, let's say, catalog entries describing my data service, policies that I attach to my data, and of course also identities, you know, because otherwise it would not work. And the reason to do that is, but I come to that later. Okay, next slide, please. So as a data space support center, having this in mind, what do? We have, let's say, three major tasks that are given to us by the Commission. First thing is we need to bring stakeholders together. As I said, we are the community to make it happen, and therefore we need to have a place where we work together, where we get to know each other, and where we can drive this forward. This is the green thing. The other thing is we need to identify common requirements so that not everyone needs to make the same mistakes and we can use synergies. I just had an hour ago another call with a relatively huge data space and they said, okay, you as a data space support center, please make sure that we use synergies so that we are all faster as if we would do it alone, you know, and that's good. Plus, we would come up with these blueprints of building blocks, which you can use as a pattern. And what is the benefit of that? Well, it accelerates your time to market, right? So if you can use something that has been proven successful in a similar case, just do it and don't have to basically develop it on your own again. And the next thing is we want to create a platform for knowledge exchange, because we can't look back on, let's say, 20 years of, let's say, experience in running data spaces. It's still a brand new thing. And it's also complex. It's federated. It has multiple layers, technology, data, governance, business model. So we need to make sure that we bring all the knowledge together that we have in order to make the best out of that. Next slide, please. Yes, and that basically also then translates to the mission. So we want to have, let's say, make sure that the data space initiatives, in particular the European fund ones, have a quick start and can accelerate scale up. We want to provide, let's say, the tools and also a blueprint or a cook recipe in the end to structure your initiative. We want to deliver blueprints, which you can use in order to speed up your activities. And of course, what we want to do is to enable, let's say, the domain-specific communities to really deliver value to their community members. As I said, we have a special focus on interoperability. Why? Well, to make sure that a company that is part in one data space can easily also be part in another one without, let's say, adopting a totally different technical and legal framework. That's the idea. If we don't do that, we would end up in silos that we typically now have inside companies, and we would just copy this picture on a broader scale. And then we will, if that happens, then we have all failed. Let's be really open with you. So we need to make sure that a certain infrastructure level ensures interoperability. Otherwise, we will not be able to use to leverage economies of scale. And that is why we need to make sure that everybody conforms to a certain set of standards. I know this, and you all know this old saying, the nice thing about standards is that there are so many to choose from. And this is also true to a certain extent in the data space domain. I have a connector which is nicer than your connector. Oh no, get rid of the connectors at all. We want to do blockchain and that's all what we need. We want to have federated identities. No, we want to have a central service. This will not get us forward. And the data space support center will say, look, at this time right now, in considering your use case, your business case, go with that stack. There might be in 3 years from now newer technologies, but now do it like that. And we also tell you a transition path to new generations of technology. This is what we want to do. All right, next picture. Next slide, please. We have a very complex work plan. And for the sake of time, I don't want to go through that. It's basically, putting our task into, our major mandate into task and work packages. And we see ourselves as a facilitator of the European data space ecosystem, let's call it like that. Next slide, please. Yes, and we also translated that into a work plan, which basically consists of six work packages. Work package one is not explicitly mentioned here, but it's the coordination. Work package two is the stakeholder management. Work package three is, let's say, information and making sure that we have everything in place that you get your information. Four and five are basically doing the core content work. So the blueprinting, the building blocks, and so on and so forth. And work package six is then, let's say, making sure that it really ends up with you guys and is helping, let's say, the individual data space initiatives to speed up. Yes, next slide, please. Right. So if we look into, let's say, community and stakeholder management, there will be a strategic stakeholder forum, of course, and this is also part of that. We also want to, let's say, drive and facilitate the communities of practice, which is important. And by the way, I think that's also part of the European way to do it, bottom up, making sure that we use the best out of everything and have different velocities and different speeds in place, but have diversity, but that needs to be brought together in communities. So collaboration with relevant initiatives and stakeholders, there is a long list of, let's say, related and concerned initiatives that we need to team up with. And also we, of course, have a close relationship to the EDIB, so the European Data Innovation Board, because we are, so to say, the operational arm of that. Right, next slide, please. And we translated that into a 100 days plan, which is in fact I think only 60 days or so, because we started on the 13th of October and we need to be up and running and have the most important things ready and before Christmas. And that will be in our case. So our 100 days end on the 16th of December. And next slide, please. I structure these activities a little bit along the lines of the three, major activities. And if you could go to the next slide, please, there you can see the list of things that we want to do. I don't want to go through everything into detail, but touch a couple of them. So I think the most important one is, let's say, to have this strategy in place to engage with the stakeholders, what we actually do. Another important thing is also that we form liaisons with standardization bodies, because our blueprints and building blocks, we will also, let's say, push them into formal standardization. we will have lots of events, which we will see later on. And we already have, let's say, a first group of data space experts appointed and equipped, so people that help you out if you have a question. And also very important, we don't start on a white sheet of paper, but we, let's say, utilize, structure, and synthesize the results of the predecessor initiatives like OpenD, like the SCDS, and so on and so forth. And also, and that will be touched upon by Tuomo in detail, therefore I just mention it here, we will come up with a starter kit for these blueprints, which will be out very soon. Right, so I'm over my time already, sorry for that. But I hope you found that useful. as said, I'm really looking forward to the collaboration with all of you guys. And once more, if we don't make it happen, no one else will do. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Boris, for explaining the DSSC and presenting it. So very, very nice. I see many questions coming in. And as already mentioned in the beginning, we will have a dedicated Q&A session starting at 5. So yeah, please write the questions you have into the chat and we will make sure to answer them. And I also see that Christoph is getting ready for the next agenda. Yes, perfect. Hello, Christoph. To give you some insights about the DSSC support levels and the data space experts. So, Christoph, with this, I would like to hand over to you. And thank you very much, Boris.
Thanks, Franziska. So welcome everyone also from my side. Christoph Mertens, my name. I'm working for the IDSA as head of adoption. As such, I would like to lead you a little bit through how the Data Spaces Support Center actually is planning to give the support to you and those who have questions or already plans. So next slide, please. This is just to tickle a little bit your brain. So actually, so I would like to buy a data space is a statement that actually during my work as one caring about the adoption of data space standards sometimes hears. So the expectation out there actually sometimes is that it's a common product that you can buy on a market like an Apple. Easy to consume, easy to use. And Boris already mentioned that the topic of data spaces actually is a little bit more complicated than that. Yeah. So it's fair to say, I would say that it's not a shame to ask for support in the attempt to build a data space or to onboard to a data space, or depending on your role, also dealing with data spaces in a different role. The technology readiness of this thing called data space is not at that point where you can easily consume it. So we as Data Spaces Support Center are out there to support. Next slide, please. How does that look? So the complexity is obviously there. The slides that Boris presented before gave you a hint on that, how complex the topic can be. It can be many different layers, technological questions, finding a role in this ecosystem. So that is really complicated. For the support and for the contact with us, we wanted to make it as easy as possible. So if you go to our webpage, currently you will be confronted with two forms that you can use. And this also will be reduced to actually one form. So this is the first level support where you just can indicate who you are, what your question is regarding data spaces, and you will reach the first level support. Next slide, please. And this is open for everyone. So you don't have to worry about if you are a funded project under a specific program, if you are funded at all, if you are just a person working for a company that wants to start dealing with this topic, or if you are part of a data space endeavor that is already in a more mature phase dealing with implementations. This is as easy as milk. So you can use the form on the webpage. You can also use directly the contact at dssc.eu email address. And the first level support is meant for quick response, easy to use, and about letting us know what your actual need is. Next slide, please. The actual more complicated thing starts then. So hopefully there will be some easy questions that can be answered by email, where we point you to certain documents or give you short and brief answers to ease your life. But actually the second level support is much more interesting. It's about bringing you in contact with the right experts. Next slide, please. Bring you in contact with the right experts, and also finding out what is your positioning in this topic of data spaces. Now, there is not the one solution fits all, not on the technological side, not on the conceptual side. It's a thing where you first have to do some learnings. And I can already tell from the learnings from the past years that a very good step into the general process of building data spaces is to admit that no one sitting at the table knows anything about data spaces. So everyone starting from scratch and elaborating the base jointly is usually something that really helps. And also throughout the process in workshops clarifies that actually there is not as much competition as one could think at the beginning while reading blog posts or dealing with it on your own. So here, this first step is about pointing you to documents, to information, bringing you in contact with a network of experts, bringing you in contact with other people from the community, and establishing a baseline for the project. The next step is about defining the needs that the project that you're aiming at has, or maybe you are also just interested in joining a data space with a specific use case or within the project setting up a demonstrator. So depending on what your need is, it can be defined how also a potential solution could look like. Then the third step always is to start building, getting your hands dirty, using components that are out there, building your own components, or even in some cases buying solutions that are already available at the market. So this is then the next step, the first step before going into the testing phase, getting things operationalized, also partly growing a network, and then last but not least, having the real deal, sharing data within data spaces. Next slide, please. These five steps, of course, as you now already got as a notion, hide a lot of complexity. It's much more complicated to deal with the topic itself. I just want to give you a quick hint on how not only to structure this process-wise in order to allow you to find out where you stand in this process and point you to the right information. It's also you can see also the 12 building blocks from the project Open Day that was just recently finalized in October. Coming up with a framework that is really handy in case you're already a bit further down the road with data spaces, starting to define architectures and how the solution could look like. This framework really helps to not forget important aspects. So these 12 building blocks, as you can see, have a huge focus on the technological aspects of how to build data spaces. But there's also this governance part, which is more about processes and legal agreements for the field, because actually also, even though at least the history also of IDSA shows that we started our journey with a strong technological view, there's much more to data spaces. Yeah, you need to think about how to onboard and offboard participants, and how to deal with things on the legal side. So this has to be considered. And these 12 building blocks are a great framework or a checklist, if you want. So to go through it and check one box after the other, making sure to not forget anything. Next slide, please. All this complexity, so like what Boris showed, what I just teasered very roughly, is something that has to be handled. And the Data Spaces Support Center, with only its core partners already, comes with experts on the field. So you can see here the list of the core partners. Next slide, please. But also the list of the extended network makes clear that this is a huge network with people that deal with data spaces already since the very beginning, being able to answer questions and solving problems for endeavors out there. Next slide, please. And this actually is a network, not with anonymous companies, but here I collected already some of the experts behind the scenes. So this is actually a real person-to-person support, you could say. And depending on the expertise that each and every single person from our expert network has, we will be able to, once identifying your need, point you to the right person to do the job for your very specific problem. Next slide, please. So can you already buy the data space? Probably not. I think that is clear to all of us, but we really are here. Please click once. We are really here to make sure. Could you please click once on the slide? Here to support you in this process and get closer to this vision of making data spaces and the story of being part of data space is as easy as binding an apple. So feel free to reach out to us. There are no questions that don't make sense. We're here to help you find your very own specific way. And I'm glad to hand back to Franziska. And also here, Tuomo already will give you a great insight, I guess, about the first step. So learning and educating yourself about this topic.
Thank you very much, Christoph. Thank you for giving us this overview and for showing us that the core of the DSSC is really the support and also that the support for the DSSC is a co-creation process, so that we need the whole community here. Now, I see Tuomo. I would like to hand over to you for one of our core assets, which is the starter kit. So the stage is yours.
Okay, very good. Thank you very much. Some great presentations. Yes, my name is Tuomo Tuikka. I work for VTT. I'm also working as the data space solutions lead at VTT, which is a new kind of job description in the Europe. And I believe that we will be seeing this kind of new job descriptions in the future as well when this data economy is forming. Yes, I also work as a work package for lead, that is the identification and synergies work package. So Boris showed already in the beginning. Please, could you switch the slide? Thank you. All right, so here is, of course, Boris explained already about the Data Spaces Support Center as a project, and I would like to say still that this is something that, you know, I have never been in a situation, research project like this, because there is clearly a lot of need and a lot of urge to create something new in the data economy in Europe, and sort of I would say that this is a pivotal moment for Europe to create something new, and really excited to be part of this evolution, and therefore we also want to be agile as a project to support the community and scale with the data space topic. Please could you switch the slide, please? All right, so this data space support center activity, the work package identification and synergies is the one of the first work packages that has been starting. Not all of them have started yet, but this has been starting, and obviously we need to know more about what is going on in the European arena of data spaces, and I think that it is very interesting to everybody to understand that what are the common requirements for data infrastructure across sectoral data spaces, what kind of common building blocks are essential for the creation of these sectoral data spaces, what are the common standards, both domain specific and cross-cutting, what kind of toolboxes we would need, what are the architectures and technical data governance frameworks, what are the potential synergies between data spaces, and what kind of data governance models, business models, strategies there are for running data spaces, And of course, we are experiencing this regulation tsunami at the moment. So there's at least, well, the five big regulations that are now either there or under work. So this is something to identify, which may really frames the work on the data spaces. And finally, there's also, we want to identify what are the guiding design principles for the creation of data spaces when we learn from the evolution of this effort. And therefore, we are reaching out to the stakeholders and community of practice and everybody who is interested in data spaces altogether. This could just switch the slide. Now, the motivation for the starter kit first of all, what is the starter kit in essence? The motivation here is that when looking at the developments that these data spaces and concepts that are related to data spaces seem to have many interpretations and definitions. So there's obviously cohesion needed in order that we understand that what we are talking about, we understand the matters that are there. So that's one really good reason to look at the terminology and the concepts of data spaces. And in general, there's an urgent need for information on data spaces. It's very obvious. Say data spaces are soon starting to scale. That's what we believe, both in sectors and growing a number of users. So there's also this interoperability. We have to have this common ground before we scale too much of data spaces. Then references and examples are needed. They already exist, many examples, and therefore we want to convey those references to the wider audience. Design approaches are necessary to make data space design systematical. It's clearly something that we are not used to do in the information systems development in general, but data spaces are something different. So we need to understand how to design them. And as I mentioned, the regulation tsunami is framing our future data ecosystems. So now it's the pivotal moment for the EU data economy in that sense. So there's many things which motivate our work. Please, can you switch the slide? Now, what is the starter kit? So as you remember, we have been starting the work quite recently, but as a milestone, we do have publication that is named Starter Kit. And the idea is that it is a starting point for your data space journey that guides you to relevant community resources and DSSC material as it becomes available. Now there's, at the moment, we have been working in really in agile manner with the community of practice and we have have been working on a 30 days version just to respond the need and also to engage the community to discussion, to reach out people. And we are planning a public community release, preliminary draft before Christmas. That would be 19th of this month. And eventually there will be final release, which are web pages with the content outlined in the described preliminary draft. That would be March 2023. But we are all the time discussing with the community and seeing that all these many aspects are taken into consideration. And while doing the discussion, I have noticed that also there are many other things that are popping up that we maybe want to categorize and classify into some other work that we have in the DSSC. So please, next slide. So what it actually is not, it's not a moderated package in a sense. We list available and known resources, but do not evaluate maturity of the solutions at this point of time. It's not a textbook, cookbook, or guidebook. Does not provide a blueprint for developing data spaces. And if you click once now, don't switch the slide, but click once, please. Yes, so these are other deliverables. So we are working on this. We are going towards that direction, but this requires more experience and planning that what are these guidelines and what is the best way to do data spaces, what kind of blueprints there are. So next slide, please. The content, maybe I have some time to go on to the content also. So it will be a short introduction to data spaces in a framework of BLOFT. It's a business, legal, and governance functionality and technology and use cases. Initial release of glossary. As I mentioned, the glossary is important, and the resources and references list. So many of the items which have been in the presentation today will be there in the resources and references. And it's very important to have a very good presentation of those important that we already have. We already have many platforms and data spaces efforts that we want to be to have listed there. I had inserted this OpenDEI image there also as a reminder that we bring in the also those background knowledge from many projects, that this is something we are doing. So the OpenDEI or ICT 13, the ICT 5, or et cetera. We don't forget that there's a lot of work which have been done and want to bring that into the DSSC effort. Please, could you switch the slide? And here is outline of the starter kit content as it is at the moment in the outline structure that was mentioned before. And if you look at the contents, there's something about design approach, how to do the design, what kind of matters there are with the data space design. Then legal and governance, data contracts, for example, are something that we are all the time wondering that how they are working. And then functionally, the technology, data interoperability, sovereignty, and trust are addressed there. So many of those concepts that we are all the time trying to understand that how to design the data spaces, how to use the concepts, how to use the building blocks, etc. Eventually, there will be also a list of pioneering use cases and which are repository of and a link repository to the use cases that exists already, and so that it's helping us to start new developments. So maybe the next one, please. So about information gathering, I don't maybe go into details, but just show that we have the information gathering ongoing at the moment. There's very hectic work, I must say, that with the colleagues who are doing the workshops and analyzing the data and doing the surveys and doing the interviews. So. We plan to resolve all these matters by January, and in the meanwhile we plan to have a preliminary draft, as I said already, before Christmas, available for study and scrutiny, and the starter kit final version will be end of March in web. Please, could you switch the slide? All right. Now, in the big picture, this work is the beginning of continuous scanning on resources available for data space developers. I believe that this is very much evolutionary effort. So we are learning and cooperating all the time and figuring out what are those let's say technical resources that are mature enough and can be used for data space development. And while doing that, we also update the web page. And already we address some of the tools that they exist. So please take a look when the release is public. So what are the existing resources? And eventually we will have design guidelines and best practices, but it's a separate track for the next year's effort. So Starter Kit has its place, and we are going to work with you all in order to make the interoperable data spaces happen, and looking forward to do this cooperation. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Tuomo. Very, very good. Thanks. So what I would like to do now is lead to the Q&A. So that we have the time also together with you, Boris, to answer some of the questions that came in via the Q&A, but also via the DSSC website. So there, Boris, I would like to direct maybe one question to you, which is coming in from Sebastian Denville on how the blueprint and building block of the DSSC will position with SIMPLE. So maybe you can elaborate on this, because also other participants of this webinar have asked this question. Thank you.
Yes, I mean, it's a good question. What we need to understand is that we always have, let's say, different levels of abstraction. I mean, that sounds very academic, so take apologies, but the blueprints have to describe what is needed to build a data space in terms of capabilities, to a certain extent, technology agnostic, because there will be different implementations for certain capabilities, right? For example, you could take different kinds of data connectors to share data and attach policies to it. So the blueprints will, on the one hand side, identify the required capabilities and then point to, let's say, standard specifications, and perhaps also point to individual implementations. SIMPLE is an implementation. So there is, in SIMPLE, nothing will be done regarding, okay, we do blueprints and give advice or something. This is software development, software engineering and development. It will end up in a, let's say, repository of open source code, which then adheres or implements the building blocks. That's the relationship. And there will also be a very close collaboration between the DSSC and the SIMPLE consortium. One, the tender has been published, and a winning consortium has been chosen. So there will be still some time to go. But then we will work very closely with the SIMPLE consortium.
Okay, thank you very much. So to those who have asked this question, of course, you can also always send an email to contact@dssc.eu, and so we can then elaborate more if there are still open issues here. Then I also see that many questions are dedicated to the cooperation with the DSSC. So maybe Boris, you can also elaborate on how we foresee official cooperation here.
Yes, I'm very happy, to be honest, that this work package is led by Anna Garcia, who basically will set up our stakeholder and community management process, and she's very embracing. So she's exactly the right person. And what we have in mind is to come up with an onion model, you know. There is, of course, the very close collaboration with the sectoral CSAs, so which will be in, let's say, in the first onion ring, so to say. And then there will be also, let's say, outer rings, in order to make sure that on one hand side, the information flows to everybody who is interested and concerned, but also there is the way back open, you know, in order to get feedback, requirements, and good ideas to be then collected in the DSSC. Also, Christoph showed this, let's say, different lines of support. Please be advised that, let's say, we can't, let's say, help you out in implementing your projects, of course, that would by far exceed our capacities. But as Christoph said, we are committed not only as a project, but also as us as individuals, to support you as best as we can. And there will be multiple channels to engage with us. And also, as I said, vice versa, of course, it's not a one direction. It's basically learning from each other and doing it together.
Great, thank you very much. And maybe one last question to you, Boris, regarding the EDIP. So how will the DSSC support the EDIP? That was also...
Yes, I'm sure that many of you have the honor to serve on, let's say, committees and boards, which is a great thing. But all of you know that, let's say, work does not happen there. Let's face it. So there will be the Data Innovation Board, and it's great that it will be installed because, let's say, is the decision-making body, let's call it like that, or the, let's say, where the authority and accountability is positioned to not only bring these ideas of common European data spaces in life in Europe, but of course also on a member state level. And of course, we also need to have, let's say the experts involved there, and let's say representatives from the domains. That's what the Data Innovation Board will do. However, it is a board, you know, and so it will look into things and will judge whether things go smoothly and into the right direction. And if not, they will basically take actions. But as I said, let's face it, the actual work will not be done there. This will be us as the place where we go down into the engine room and get our hands dirty. And that's more fun, by the way.
Great. Okay. So then I have here a question I think that is, Tuomo, you could answer this regarding the scope of the governance aspects in the 12 building blocks. So maybe you can answer this one.
Oh, okay. Do you know, Boris, that what was the question?
So the question is like, if you could elaborate a bit on the governance aspect in the building blocks. So what is the scope on this?
Yeah, so I think that now we are working on this scoping and how to identify and look at the governance scope. So in fact, this is something we are at the moment working on, so that there is a separate task that is looking at the scope of governance and also business models and so on. So at the moment it's a bit early to start discussing about what is the scope, because we are coming back to that in next weeks, I believe.
Okay, thank you so much. And then there is maybe a question that builds upon this question or your answer, whether the starter kit is like a landscape of services and technologies around building data spaces, if that could be is the case. So maybe you can also help here Jan Fischer, who has asked this question. So is the starter kit like a landscape of services and technologies around building data?
Yeah, that's a good question. It's practically, what it is that it shows the resources which exist already at the moment. It can be also that there is some services at the moment. I don't see that yet in the list of the resources, but of course this kind of like service providers and that could be like available. Of course we are not like in a position to promote services maybe, but it's a very restricted document at the moment, but it will be a decision of the editing board in order to look at what to include, and maybe that is something that we will also discuss with the group, that if we will have this kind of broader landscape.
Okay, perfect, thank you very much. And then Christoph, I see one question coming in via the website. So it's from a privately organized data space. The focus is on scaling and use by the participants or the customers. So what do typical application scenarios look like for which data spaces are ideally suited, especially compared to data platforms? Maybe you can help here.
I mean, this already is a question that would lead us to a quite high level of complexity. So it actually depends. Yeah? So, but the keywords like platforms, for instance, show that, of course, data spaces have to embrace existing solutions. Yeah? So it's more of an evolution of platform economy and how we currently deal with data in marketplaces and cloud ecosystems. Rather than swiping everything off the table and starting from scratch. So here in this specific case with this question, it would be worth to sit together to identify the participants, the people and parties active or being interested in being active within the data space. Having a look at the services that I want to provide in order to find out what is the exact positioning within it. Yeah, does the solution that has to be onboarded to a data space, be equipped with a connector, how can the service be offered to other participants, and so on and so forth. It's a great question because it shows the complexity and that there is not this one answer on such a question. But what is required is really to sit at a table to have a look at the topic, to start sketching, and sometimes also make clear to the people that ask the questions or own a platform that the solution that they have at hand is not the data space itself, but rather a potential participant within a bigger ecosystem. So I think it was Boris who showed this slide with different levels of data sharing. With federations at the end and data spaces in the middle and one-on-one data exchange on the very left side. So here positioning this and clarifying on what would be the next evolutionary step to be taken is, I think, the right approach here.
Okay, thank you so much. And then maybe once more a question regarding external initiatives and how they can engage with the DSSC. So if an organization has experts in certain fields of data spaces, so is there any way to engage with the DSSC?
Yeah, great question. And also I saw flickering through one other question that asks about the relation of the DSBA and the DSSC, so the Data Spaces Business Alliance versus the Data Spaces Support Center. And the answer to the actual question here is that it depends on what it is that you provide. So is it expertise on a specific field that is requested by data space initiatives and you as an organization feel like being an expert on the field, maybe even guided already data space projects or initiatives to a certain success? To join this group of experts that I quickly showed you? Or is it rather that with your expertise and your, I think in the startup scenario, you're talking about software products and services that you are implementing. Is it rather that you have specific ideas about the standard behind data spaces itself? In this case, the DSBA is a very good home because the Data Spaces Business Alliance that is constituted of the International Data Spaces Association, Gaia-X, BDVA, Big Data Valley Association, and FIWARE, rather is concerned with the process of defining the baseline for data spaces, whereas the Data Spaces Support Center is more constituted around giving answers to questions and offering guidelines and guiding. So depending on the specific interest, we can for sure find a home here for the person who asked this question.
Okay, thank you so much. And here I once more would like to emphasize that you can always contact us via email as well. And then we can also schedule a call or have a follow up on this because sometimes, yes, these Q&A sessions and webinars are maybe not do not answer the questions completely. No. Then Mrs. Eisenträger, you asked whether you could get the contact information of the person responsible for the sectoral CSAs. So yes, this indeed would maybe be better if you just reached out to us via email and then we can put you in contact with our colleague. Then also I see a question, or maybe more like a, so isn't the regulation tsunami term too negative? Shouldn't we appreciate the EU effort? So yes, indeed. So maybe Tuomo, we can, I mean, yes, of course, we very much see the effort of the European Commission to regulate this, the data space in the space. So we should maybe not compare it to a natural disaster, but yeah. But it's let's see. Yes, thank you very much for this comment. And then, yeah, I see other questions. I think some of them we will take with us because we cannot answer them right away. So we will, yeah, monitor them. Then I see another question on the edit once more. So here, Teemu Roponen is our contact. Main contact when it comes to the EDIP activities, and he has also recorded a great video that explains more in detail the relation with the EDIP and the DSSC. So maybe Alessandra, I could ask you to post this link into the chat so yeah, people can access it. And then Tuomo, I see one more question. I know you elaborated on the OpenDI initiative, but are there any other, so to say, projects, initiatives that the Data Spaces Support Center will build upon? So yes.
Yeah, definitely. We are just doing this identification and have been. As said already, that we have this stakeholder engagement and community of practice. So through these colleagues, this identification and synergies work effort is done. So yes, there are not only OpenDI but many ICT projects that have very much good information or experience already with the different technologies and different experiences with the use cases. So this is clearly the case that we are not only basing our effort to OpenDI, but it's of course it's good work, but we need to have this kind of broad view on these developments that have been there. So it's very crucial to have the handover of information and take that to the future efforts of data spaces that we are seeing also in the future calls and future efforts.
Thank you very much, Tuomo. Then there's another question which I like very much. So it says, the currently listed data spaces seem not to be the end of possible data spaces, e.g. there is no provision for a water data space, which given climate change might be argued for. Who, if anyone, will take care of how emerging data spaces can learn from existing efforts? Maybe Christoph, this is a question for you. And I really like this question because it shows that the DSSC's work, the DSSC's project, which takes 3.5 years, might even establish then, like, not to say, but like go beyond this, because in 3.5 years of time, new data spaces will emerge. So Christoph, over to you.
Yeah, thank you very much. Yeah, indeed, excellent question. So the overview and the transparency over things that happen and how can others learn from examples that are already on their way, maybe even succeeded within the boundaries and the rules that they defined for themselves, is excellent. So we at IDSA already deal with this since our beginning, and one solution that also will be published within the context of DSSC to broaden the view, to open it up to a much broader community, is actually the data space radar. So if you want to have a look at it, the current version under the umbrella of IDSA already exists on IDSA's homepage, but something like this and even better will be created within the DSSC. So here, this will be a tool, a radar, where project examples, independent of their maturity, can register themselves in order to be displayed. That sounds quite simple. And in the first step, it also is. because it just creates an overview over what is floating around out there. Yeah. So an example from the medical field with a maturity of, we just did a napkin drawing and thought about building a data space, all the way up to here, you can have a look at the mobility data space or Katana X or other projects that, that might already be familiar to you as audience also, and making the contact. So usually there is a contact point behind each and every data space and example that is listed in the radar. So you can reach out to the initiative, to the person behind it, and get in contact. So this is the idea of creating transparency on the field of which data space is out there, who's thinking about what, because also during the ramp up here of the project, even during the proposal phase, I was really thrilled by the examples that I learned about that are not part of our radar so far, but that obviously exist out there. And it's absolutely worth to bring this knowledge out there.
Cool. Thank you very much, Christoph. And I see another question, Tuomo. Maybe you can help here regarding the starter kit once more. So the accessibility of the starter kit once it's published, like where do we publish it and how can people access it?
Maybe Franziska and Tuomo, before you get into this, I see there's a follow-up question regarding what I said about the radar. About if the IDSA radar is moving towards the DSSC. So actually, this is also a signal out there that forces are joined out there between the different stakeholders that are behind DSSC and, for instance, also the SBA. We as IDSA, of course, have a huge interest in making visible what kind of IDS-based technology is used in which initiative. Now, that is also something that we want to do in the future, while at the same time seeing that there are examples that also try to figure out their own way, using one part of what Gaia defines, one part of things that they define on their own, maybe some domain specifics. So the world is much more colorful than this, and it's absolutely worth to have a home for it. Bringing me to one functionality that has to be part of the radar, which is filtering down. So maybe I have a huge interest in seeing examples that are using only one very specific solution. Yeah, maybe I want to see all the data spaces that selected blockchain as a technology for solving a specific problem. So I would like to be able to filter down to that. And this is also how we envision the radar under the umbrella of DSSC. So if I want, I can click on just show me the IDS-based data spaces and we're good to go.
Great, thank you so much, Christoph. Let's see whether there comes another follow-up question on your answer now. So then, Tuomo, I hand over to you for the accessibility of the starter kit.
Yeah. The plan is, you saw already the website address that dssc.eu the release will be there and before Christmas. And that I have to remind again that it's the preliminary draft, which is used for you know, scrutiny, and then we go towards the website release, which is the end of March. So the things will happen after that, of course, also when it's released in the as a PDF, and this is something that also we need to know, well, interact with the community, that if there is something like we should be doing, or if there's something that you have there, so that should be at the website. So we just take them in and make also decision on how to deal with those proposals.
Great, thank you, Tuomo. And I don't know whether you can answer that one, but James Schoening is asking, for semantic interoperability, are you tracking the emerging standard ontologies from ISO and IEEE? Maybe you can help with that answer. If not, we can reach out to you, Mr. Schoening. afterwards.
Yeah, that might, it's a bit specific question.
Yes.
At this point. So.
Yeah, but maybe one answer that is not yes or no, but at the end, this also shows that the understanding about what is a data space achieving, that's a complex topic. So here, with this question on domain-specific ontologies, this is something that the data space has to solve on top of the usage of standards that already exist out there. So the data space standards from the initiatives here in the DSSC usually stop at the domain agnostic level. So the ontologies also that are defined on in the context of Gaia and IDSA for the purpose of making data spaces a semantical environment stop at the level where you would be saying, okay, here I tell you how to label medical data or data for manufacturing, which is, I think, the standards that you are also referring to. Not saying that this is not of interest for the data space itself, but this is something that comes on top of the, we have to build the foundation for a data space.
Thank you, Christoph. And then there's also another question that goes into that direction. What is the DSSC doing and what is it not doing? So there's a question, after defining a data space, e.g. in medicine, are you interested in ensuring that the resulting data is identified and reproducible? So maybe, Christoph, you can also help here on the expectations of what the DSSC does and not does.
Yeah, so the name Data Spaces Support Center shows a bit about this purpose. It's the support center. So showing initiatives the way to the right solutions, to the standards that they should use in order to create interoperability, data sovereignty, and trust within their ecosystem for the DSSC could be enough. But of course, the target to, I think, identifying and making things reproducible, it sort of refers to the FAIR principle of sharing data. Yeah? Things like findable, interoperable, accessible, yeah? These attributes that data have to have and the environment has to support this is something that is maybe not in the DNA of the Data Spaces Support Center, but for sure within the DNA of the initiatives defining the standards for it. So like I said at the beginning or throughout the Q&A, the Data Spaces Business Alliance is caring about that. So DSSC might maybe not, but in general, this aspect after having the data space to have these attributes, identifying data, reproducing data, you could count it to the standard itself. Yeah.
Thank you very much, Christoph. And maybe this is another question here that comes in as a good transition to Alessandra. Maybe you could once more share the slides and show the slide with the upcoming events and insight series, because we are asked whether we have a newsletter in place, and that is for the moment not the case, but what we have is a very vivid insight series which we have kicked off, so to say, today. And the next webinar or insight series will take place in January on the 26th of January, also from 4 to 5:30, and then we will do this on a monthly basis, having each month another insight series. And there we want then also to invite the other data CSA data spaces and present to you the recent results of the project, and we will inform you about the next so to say topic, and in via our website and via LinkedIn. So I think these were maybe the main questions we received. Maybe Christoph or Tuomo, you would like to add anything else, or any message you would like to give to the community. I say thank you very much for joining today's Insight Series. It was a pleasure. And I hope that we could answer your question. We had the DSSC presented the starter kit of how to give some support, and we are happy to receive emails and receive your questions or other messages from you via email, via our contact form. So Christoph, Tuomo, over to you.
So thank you very much for the invitation. It was a pleasure being here. And yeah, I'm sure not all questions are solved. Therefore, we are here. Make plenty of use of the email address or the form on our webpage. We are glad to support you on your journey towards data spaces.
Yeah, thank you from my part also. It has been a pleasure to be here and hear the questions. And we will also work on the topic quite a lot, and looking forward to meet you everybody in the future stages. And I think maybe it's at this point of time it's pretty much Merry Christmas all.
True.
That's true. So Merry Christmas everybody, and see you latest next year. Bye bye.